Ballarat is a major regional city located in Victoria. It's one of the richest goldfields to have ever been discovered. But this area isn't actually as rich as it appears, and I'll explain why in this video. Ballarat is deceiving in many, many ways. And this deception cast by this ancient landscape has led to the city surviving and prospering when really it should have died when the gold ran out. But that's the thing, it never did. Because beneath the rivers that were hit so hard during the earliest days lay older rivers, buried deep, sometimes beneath dozens of meters of thick basaltic rock, and other times it lay up to 100 or so meters below it. So when these initial waterways were exhausted, the deep digging began. Tons of gold were pulled out of these ancient rivers, and then, after much of this was exhausted, Ballarat faced a problem again. Now, around this time, when the gold that was mined from the present-day rivers got exhausted, Ballarat was more or less given two choices. Invest in exploring for more river gold, also known as alluvial gold, or resort to crushing quartz. In the late 1850s, hard rock machinery was primitive to say the least, with ore crushers being invented around this time for this purpose. The gold that hadn't yet been eroded by the eons that had passed since it was originally shot through the fractures within the earth in a molten state was still there, tied up within the quartz, with it sometimes being visibly tied up. And gold in quartz was visible everywhere around Ballarat around this time. In every place that wasn't covered over by a basaltic lava flow, more or less lay a gold-rich quartz vein, outcropping on the surface in a very proud and pronounced stance, due to the fact that it was more erosion-resistant than the surrounding sediment, and often quartz veins would be interlain with rich amounts of very visible gold, sometimes shot all throughout the many fractures that existed. And this is where Ballarat gets a little cheeky. The early towns to start crushing did so because the quartz veins that were mined paid an amount that was more than the operating costs of the mine. But this type of mining was stupidly expensive. Many different machines were required, and large amounts of capital was often necessary for one of these companies to even have a chance of getting off the ground. So it had to be a damn good bit of gold-rich quartz for them to actually be able to profitably mine this. But in Ballarat, the quartz was shit. Seriously, it was absolutely trash in its yield. Most companies back then tried to get an ounce per ton at the very least around this time. But in Ballarat, the quartz barely gave 4 grams to the ton. This is just an average, and in rare occurrences it was more. But in general, Ballarat has some pretty shit quartz. So why the heck was there so much gold that had been eroded from the quartz here? And why is the amount so pronounced in Ballarat compared to the surrounding gold fields, which have quartz veins that have a much higher ratio of gold per ton than what's found in Ballarat? Well, it has to do with the height it's at. That's right, the height. Because Ballarat is more or less the top of the dividing range in this part of Victoria. And as a result of that, it's eroded much, much more than the surrounding topographically lower lands. Meaning more gold has been deposited here as a result of more quartz being worn down to a particle size and releasing the gold that was interlain within it. And because of this, things got tricky. Because quartz was everywhere, but you had to crush tons upon tons for it to even have a chance of being profitable. And that was almost impossible to do at this time in the late 1850s. So Ballarat saw an incredible amount of companies go bust in a decade that followed. Many, many people lost their entire fortune. And many others got swindled when people would offer false promises to investors, or make falsified discoveries, where they'd lie about the yield per ton. But amongst all the trash, a few companies learned to work around and even to benefit off the low-yield quartz that existed in Ballarat. The Black Hill Mining Company is one such example of a groundbreaking and extremely profitable mine that operated here for 40 years. And during that time, it tore the mountain here asunder, creating an entirely new valley within it, as they bulk crushed an incredible amount of ore, and utilized a very smart and money-efficient way of transporting it, utilizing a hard rock miner's best, or worst friend, if they fall down their shaft, gravity. But in general, if you're a small-time prospector, I'd advise you to not waste your time looking for hard rock ore here if you actually want to make a buck. But then again, I could just be f***ing with you to keep all the quartz to myself. Nah, I'm just joking. Or am I? Yeah, I am. There's a great book about this called The Astonishing History of Ballarat, Volume 3, and it actually mentioned the amount of quartz that was necessary to be eroded to release the amount of gold that was found in the alluvial days of Ballarat. And it touches on the difficulties of setting up a hard rock mine here in the 1850s onwards, and the many challenges and successes that occurred, in the spectacular goldfields of Victoria, and I highly recommend it. Thanks for watching. In this video, I'm going to discuss the goldfield that definitely exists under Melbourne, and it's been found too. The real issue isn't whether or not gold exists, it's whether or not you can access it, and more importantly, whether or not it's payable. The earliest accounts of gold existing in Victoria occurred during the 1840s. Shepherds and farm labourers would stumble across nuggets inside waterways, or they'd see visible gold inside quartz rocks. Mining was illegal back then, as gold and all metals were the property of the crown, and the discovery of gold was also actively discouraged. But as always, there's people who gave a big middle finger to the rules, and one of the first was a fella known as Gum the Gold Hunter. He lived in a hut in Plenty Ranges, now known as the Warrandyte Goldfields, and he'd be doing his thing over there. And along with this, a secretive underground black market trade existed, and many shepherds and farm labourers would sell it to jewellers in Melbourne on the hush-hush. Then, in the 1850s, New South Wales discovered it had gold, and Victoria's hand was finally forced. They had to find and release their own gold discoveries in order to not lose all of their skilled labour to the rushes that were occurring in New South Wales. And it was around this time that gold would be found in Melbourne. Here's the issue though. One of the first regulations that existed back during those early days, which governed gold mining in Victoria, stated that mining could not take place within 1 mile of a settlement or station that was in existence prior to the discovery of gold. And thus, this made any mining illegal, as Melbourne and its surrounding suburbs already existed back then. And this is more or less what halted the real discovery here. The first discovery of gold, near Melbourne's CBD, was thought to be a fluke. A labourer in Richmond discovered gold whilst digging a post hole. Now, many stories were complete furphies, but some of them were legitimate finds. And there is no question about it, there was definitely gold under Melbourne. Take this article from the Argus, posted on Monday the 28th of July in 1851. Gold was found in the soil at the western end of Bourke Street, and the guy who discovered it? Well, it's the same fella who claimed to have been the discoverer of the Bendigo goldfield. Then, in August of 1851, in a lane in Lonsdale Street between Exhibition and Spring Street, a white rock fragment was poking out of the ground, and two children came across it and dug it out with a stick. They saw a quote, pretty thing in it, and they showed their mother, who then took it to a jeweller for examination. A man named Mr. Crate in Swanston Street tested it, weighed it, and pronounced it to be a pure specimen weighing just over half an ounce. Now, you can just imagine how many people walked past this quartz rock that had half an ounce of gold inside it without realising. As previously mentioned, mining was banned in Melbourne, but people still dug in spite of the law. Several folks from the localities where discoveries were made set to work and found, at a depth of only 18 inches from the surface, a bed of dark quartz, which generated massive excitement, which was then never mentioned or spoken about again, and thus no one knows what the heck happened here, but suppression is a possibility, and the most probable culprit to this fizzling out, of course. Regardless of this, things still began to get a little out of control. Lonsdale Street and the northern end of town began to change to something more resembling a gold rush city. Claims of gold finds were continually made. One of gold being found at Lonsdale Street was made near the old Treasury building, by a digger that had worked the grounds in Ballarat. He spotted the same bluish clay that he had encountered in Ballarat, and, out of curiosity, tested a few lumps of it and found specks of gold inside. This sparked a rush, and several parties began to work with pick and shovel, and one man was witness to have extracted a nugget that was the size of a large pea. A reporter that was on the scene concluded that there is no doubt whatsoever that there is gold there and in large abundance. On the 2nd of September in 1853, gold had been discovered on Emerald Hill in South Melbourne. Half a dozen small nuggets, with the largest being about half the size of a small pea, were presented to a reporter for the Argus. At one time, about 100 persons had assembled there, and our reporter saw and heard of in the possession of various persons as many as about 50 nuggets. Besides this, he saw gold in all various stages of washing. Several applications to get the right to dig were made, but all were met with stiff refusal. Eventually, the law cracked down and stopped any further digging here. It seems like this area of Melbourne is quite auriferous, as at the west end of Lonsdale Street, as you approach Flagstaff Hill, another find would be made. One find in 1856 was responsible for breaking up a church service, and by the time it was over, over 100 of the parishioners were out digging using whatever implements they had on them to pry specks of gold from the familiar blue-tinged clay. By the early 1860s, gold had been found in the footpath of Hoddle Street, at Paran Railway Station, on Batman's Hill, which is now the site of Spencer Street Station, and at Templestowe and Heidelberg. But these finds didn't raise as much of a sensation anymore. A man offered a geological explanation in 1862 for the presence of gold in Melbourne and its suburbs. He noticed the absence of gravel in Melbourne, and by studying rail and road cuttings in Paran and Richmond, he predicted that a large deep lead ran through Melbourne to the bay, and he proposed prospecting under the basalt and adjacent to the high ground furthest from the present-day Yarra River. In later decades, boreholes were sunk to find this, but nothing really ever came up. So where's the gold coming from? Well, everywhere. The man who offered an explanation for the presence of gold was right to some extent. There sure are plenty of rivers that were buried in the past 7 million years as volcanic eruptions roared forth and oozed lava time and time again, burying pretty much everything in its way. But what the man didn't realise is that, well, Melbourne is a goldfield, as much as any other part of Victoria is. It was as much involved in the cycles of tectonic collision and later mineralisation as all of the other parts of Victoria are. It's just all under basalt. And this is cool, but it also sucks, because the basalt is deep and tough as anything to break through. So how were shallow deposits found? Well, if you look at the locations where they were actually found and overlay a geological map, you can see a bit of a trend, and that is they were all pretty much found in areas with either no basalty cover or with very little. It's not so much that Melbourne had the old Yarra making it auriferous, as it is the fact that Melbourne is itself auriferous. And there are many examples where the strange gold mines that dot Melbourne, of which there are a few by the way, were all found in areas where basalty cover was non-existent or very shallow in its deposition. So really, the gold that was found in the Silurian geological area that was outcropping in Melbourne, which is over 440 million years old, and was deposited around the time that Victoria began to become as gold-enriched as it would turn out to be. So, as you can see, we have the typical basaltic cover that's seen around much of Victoria here, and the Tullamarine basalt flow in orange over here. The purple, though, is the Silurian Melbourne formation, and if there's mineralisation and quartz veins that shot through this formation, like it did with the Castle Main Group that we see in the richest gold fields from Ballarat to Bendigo, then it's this sedimentary layer that would host it. And as you can see, very little of this purple layer exists in Melbourne, as the vast majority of it is covered in basaltic flows. That is, until we go a little east, and what do you know? There's the Warrandyke goldfields. Just another example of the fact that these deposits were always here, and are just a natural part of the land like they are in Ballarat, Castlemaine or Bendigo. It's just covered in that cheeky basalt. So grab a shovel and dig your nice little garden or your freshly mowed turf in your backyard in Melbourne. You might just find some good gold right underneath ya. It's worth a go at the very least. Thanks for watching. This incredible stretch of land is pockmarked with small holes that were dug during the massive gold rush that occurred here during the 1850s. In this particular site, miners were chasing a deep lead. What is a deep lead, you ask? Well, it's an ancient river that was buried by lava or sediment. In the past 7 million years, Victoria was transformed into the third largest volcanic plain to exist on our planet. So in this episode, we're going to look at the deep lead in Denali and discuss its creation. If you went to Denali today, you'd be forgiven for thinking that no volcanoes exist. The eruptions that once covered this land are more or less eroded away. But if you look carefully, you can see the stubs of the ancient volcanoes that once roared to life here. The entire drainage system of ancient Victoria was entirely altered when these eruptions were at their climax. After all, when lava is released, it's just like water. It flows downhill, following existing drainage channels. And when these lava flows reach the many creeks and rivers that existed, they just flow over them and bury them in time, increasing in thickness with each wave of lava that was released. The affected drainage channels would largely disappear, and when it rained, the water would be forced to carve new rivers out. These new rivers are the present-day ones that exist. So back to Denali. This deep lead here was just that, an ancient river that once flowed through here. Many of these deep leads are located quite close to the present-day river that exists, but their direction can sometimes be completely skewed. And in some areas, rivers flowed the complete opposite way to where they do today. And there's a pretty obvious reason this happens. It's all dependent on the amount of lava that is extruded from the nearby volcanoes. If the ancient river is only covered by a small layer of lava, it wouldn't be enough to completely erase the original topography that existed here. And water will then accumulate after rains and slowly carve out new channels close to the original river, as it makes its way downstream. The random nature of the lava flows, and the amount of it, dictates where the recent river flows lead. In other places, so much lava was erupted that entirely new rivers were created well away from the old ones that existed. The present-day material that the miners dug through to reach the deep lead was the eroded remains of this basalt, along with the material that was eroded from the surrounding Ordovician age sedimentary rocks. This deep lead here is largely side by side with the modern day channel that replaced it after it was buried. This modern day channel though is a shadow of its former glory. It's tiny compared to the mighty river that once flowed through here, which was on average about 100 meters wide when it flowed. But the land has never really been the same since these eruptions occurred, and you can clearly see that by looking at the geological map, where we have absolutely no alluvial material nearby. It's all colluvial material, meaning water isn't flowing through here enough to sort this material out based on its specific gravity. So the material here is a mixture of a whole heap of different things that are emplaced in somewhat of a rubble-like manner. This means recent gold deposits here aren't properly sorted, and you can find pieces of it anywhere throughout the material, rather than right at the bottom, like what would normally happen when water is allowed to properly flow and to sort material out in a layer-like manner, such as what would occur with alluvial deposits. And this is a big issue, because that means you have to process all of the material rather than being able to isolate a rich layer of it, creating more labor, which uses more water and finds a lesser amount of gold in the end. Up north, we see alluvium existing in this ancient 360 million year old granodiorite Devonian intrusion because of how long this water has been allowed to weather the material down and accumulate. And once upon a time, a little over 7 million years ago, a mighty river would have raged past this area. So in present day, the old lead diggings consists of several thousand remnant mining shafts that were sunk to try to reach this ancient river. Between 30,000 to 50,000 miners worked this lead in 1856, after the discovery of large nuggets were made. The shafts needed to be dug 10 to 20 meters deep, depending on the depth of the ancient river, to reach the gold that would be neatly sorted, with the largest nuggets occurring right at the bottom of the ancient riverbed due to how heavy gold is. Unlike the surrounding modern-day colluvial material, which was a nightmare to work due to the gold not being properly sorted as previously mentioned, the nuggets that existed in this lead contained many that were over 20 ounces in weight. At the moment, 1 ounce is around 2,700 Australian dollars. Now, this type of mining was super dangerous. Collapses were common, the ground was unstable, and flooding in shafts was quite a frequent thing to contend with, as these ancient buried paleo rivers would still actually flow to some extent, as the water from rains would seep into the ground and would still pass through them, even though it's buried 10 to 20 meters beneath the earth. So this is the amazing Old Lee Diggings in Denali, one of the best preserved sites in Victoria, where you can get a glimpse at what the land would have looked like back in the day during the gold rushes that occurred in this entire state, en masse, for over 50 years. Thanks for watching. What's the first thing you do when you rent a new house? Your answer is probably something an average, well-adapted person would say. Like, you look forward to planning out where the furniture is going and how you're going to feng shui the heck out of the place. The first thing I do when renting a new house is dig a hole. I like digging holes. It's always been a fun pastime of mine. I've dug many holes, in many places, in many weather conditions, and through many soil types. But in general, I do have a reason to dig said holes. And in this video, I'm going to tell you how digging this most recent hole went. So I dug a hole in this new place. I'll give you an insight into my mindset because I base my decision to rent a property on whether or not the geology of a specific area is favourable regarding it being gold bearing. So once I find something I like on domain or realestate.com, I'll get onto the geological maps and see what material layer exists there. Then I'll look at any previous mineral discoveries or resource exploitation in the area. After this, I'll look at fault maps and assess the topography of the area before finishing my investigation by utilizing geophysical methods. And this gives me a powerful clue about what I'm applying for. I assess topography to know what kind of prospecting work I intend to do. For example, if the house is situated on or near an alluvial body, I would engage in alluvial work. My last rental property was alluvial. It was an ancient river that was covered by basalt, then recent erosion reformed it into a new creek that flows in a completely different direction from where it used to run. Now, if the topography showed me an elevation, I'd apply eluvial and hard rock prospecting tactics. That means I'd be looking for areas either situated in a natural drainage channel or in the regions that were right near the peak of the mountain for reasons that I can't fully get into right now to save time, because it's a whole video in its own right. Still, it has to do with a higher probability of heavy mineral enrichment due to a phenomenon known as a saddle reef, which you can Google to get more info on. I've been planning a video on this topic for a while, but everyone got sick of me rehashing that road cutting video, and rightly so I had to save it for another road cutting with an exposed saddle reef like that one had. Whether or not this particular saddle reef yielded gold is another story. Still, when saddle reefs do have gold, they usually have inordinate amounts compared to the surrounding ore body. So ideally, I'd like a property where I could intercept the possible point that I predict the anticline to be situated at or near. I typically assess the topography and cross-reference that with geological and geophysical fault maps to see if I can assemble a pattern. Before I go further, I need to state I never actually mine the properties, I just get a kick out of seeing whether or not I can ascertain the potential for it to bear gold without even seeing it. And I'm 2 out of 2 so far with my rentals. I just wish I dug up the rentals that I had in Melbourne before these two, and they are forever missed opportunities, as I hadn't yet realised the potential to find gold literally everywhere back then. Now my reasoning for not really going further beyond the prospecting phase is because I don't want to be disrespectful to my landlord, and I really do mean that. I would hate to be a landlord and to have some chick kicker rip up my yard and fuck shit up. Still, a tiny little hole is quickly covered and unrecognisable after some grass seeds are sown, and time is allowed to do its thing. I always make sure to leave the place better than I found it, and that's purely due to my principles and my attempt to be a good human being. When I applied for this place in particular, I knew it was just below the summit of what was once an extensive mountain range. Some might assume that there'd be no alluvial, or in this case, colluvial material worth assessing to ascertain the minerals in the soil here. After all, past gold rushes and other valuable mineral discoveries were customarily made in the alluvial waterways, meaning in rivers, creeks, tributaries, and all of that stuff. Not in a dry patch on the side of a random, pronounced, and undeniable mountain range that I now call home. But they'd be wrong, because this is not only a great way to skip the BS, but it's also a valuable way to discover any potential mineral-bearing reefs that exist nearby, and that is, with erosion slowly being worn down and releasing their contents to the world. Because if there's anything even remotely valuable present, it's very clearly coming from somewhere elevated, nearby, where the ore that contains it is slowly shedding it with time. So I went into this with the mindset that this is the stubs of an ancient mountain range. We have the typical major anticline-syncline complex occurring here, along with the many minor ones that exist in between. But because this mountain that I live on is one of the more prominent and pronounced peaks, I knew the best probability to find any gold-bearing reefs would be close to the top. So I dug a hole and, yep, gold was found. But something else that's piqued my interest about this place is the inordinate number of houses nearby that have fences constructed from basalt. And not your bought from the quarry type basalt, these are very clearly locally sourced. And I can't as of yet ascertain their origin. I know they're unrelated to the most recent wave of volcanism. Victoria had a very unusual precursor to its most recent wave of volcanism, known as the Older Volcanics, and these eruptions occurred between 20 to 30 million years ago. But I also see other forms of basalt on the very peak of this hill, and I wonder whether or not these are the Cambrian Age basalt that I've seen in some elevated areas to the north of here. If this is the case, these are the oldest rocks in Victoria, which have been thrust up from the deepest point, and they now outcrop. And if this is that type of basalt, this is the rock from which all of Victoria's gold was derived. Once subducted, millions upon millions of kilometers worth of oceanic basalt released their gold, which sequestered and accumulated and then got shot up alongside the quartz to produce the numerous veins that exist in the land today. I'm not going to lie, seeing this basalt in my backyard is tripping me the f*** out. This is one of the reasons I love moving to entirely new areas that I have absolutely zero familiarity with, and far away from where I usually live, because I've just begun this journey and I already have at least a dozen questions. But back to the point, I dug a hole in the least likely location that you'd expect to find gold, and it's a stupid location, but it's not because it skips the BS. I can't be bothered digging deep holes anymore. Let me just be the first to state that I've paid my dues when it comes to that. I know if gold is present, no matter what, it will be there, even in areas where it shouldn't and won't accumulate for longer than one or a few heavy rains. But because it's on a slope, that also means the sediment accumulation is low, so I don't have to dig much. And this is precisely what I mean. This is less than a foot of material compared to what could have been many feet if I dug in an area where there is a flattening out of the land, which would act as a natural gold trap due to water pressure differentials during a flood event. But I cut the crap and I got my result here. And gold is moving downhill from somewhere here. Can I intercept the vein on this property and crush some ore just for chits and giggles? That's one question on my mind. The second lies in the drainage channel, which I've yet to dig. So for now, this is the discovery of gold on my new rental property, only a short distance away from the busy metropolitan city of Melbourne, in an area that's not listed as barren gold on a single map anywhere. Mind-blowing stuff. Thanks for watching. Nope, not clickbait. I found one of the rarest forms of gold today. So yeah, I have an incredible update. After yesterday's video, when I found specks in the side of the hill, I just couldn't help myself today. I had to further investigate the recent discovery on this new property of mine, and I can't believe what I found. I dug another hole in an area more synonymous with a drainage channel. I dug about 2 feet down until I hit the bedrock, and when I did, I scooped the material out and panned it off as it was. Yesterday, I classified the material down, meaning I ran it through a sieve to separate the larger and smaller objects. Today, I couldn't be bothered doing that, so I panned it out with the larger rocks in there, taking them out bit by bit as I reduced the material down. And as you'll find out in a moment, being lazy today was a really, really good idea. Why? Because this is probably the first spot that I've ever discovered Y-gold in my life. Yes, you heard that right, Y-gold, the rarest state that gold can exist in on our planet. In my backyard. It's so rare that specimens of quartz that contain Y-gold are easily worth over quadruple the price of the gold present in the specimen itself. But I just panned this about half an hour ago as of recording this, so this is a very new and highly, highly unexpected discovery for me to have made. I was expecting, you know, like small specks of gold, possibly flakes, and maybe, just maybe, a small nugget. Instead, I got something so much rarer. Y-gold has long been a gorgeous enigma to scientists, but along with the usual state that we find it in, gold, like any other mineral, can also grow into stunning crystals as it emerges from naturally heated, mineral-rich waters flowing through the faults and fractures in rock. When these crystals are elongated, they're often called wires. Guys, I'm not going to lie, when I was panning this, I was like, oh, isn't that cool? We have some copper wire here. I wonder how long this has been here and where it came from. Then I found two more pieces, and when they revealed that familiar golden glint upon closer inspection, you can bet I was speechless, and then I was ecstatic. This means the host rock that's shedding this is most likely underneath the house or close to it. Hopefully it isn't on the next property up from me, because what I'd love to do is locate it and to also accumulate some more of these wires and melt them down into a tiny golden bead on cam for you all to see. Along with this, we have what appears to be a significant amount of antimony here, and this reminds me of the Ringwood district and the gold slash antimony mine that existed there. And even though I'm nowhere near that area, I'm still situated on the same tectonic province, so it's clear the paired geology is yielding the same results in my location as what exists in Ringwood. Antimony is the silvery metal you see here, and there is of course a lot of fine gold at the end of the pan. This is known as flower gold, and if you get enough, you can make it worth your while. But I'm really shocked over the revelation that wire gold is present on this property, and look at the size of this big one here, like far out. But I'm also sickened by the fact that I most likely chucked out a bunch of wire gold when I made the video that I released yesterday because I stupidly classified it down. And there's no way any large wiry pieces like these ones would have made it through the tiny holes in the sieve. Damn it! So I just wanted to share this discovery with you guys. If left to do its thing, eventually these pieces of wire gold would slowly make their way downhill to the waterway where they'd be rolled up and smushed by boulders during flood events, meaning they'd lose their shape. But to find it in this form is so cool. I can't even tell you guys how excited I am. I would so love to see this still inside the host rock, wherever it is. This tells me that something else happened here. Wire gold is commonly associated with intrusive volcanism, so it's possible a volcanic dike underlies the property and is shedding this. I'm yet to read anything about wire gold being found in or near to this district, but honestly I've never looked. So I'll need to look into this now because, like I said, I really didn't expect this. And that's why I want to encourage you guys to buy a miner's right for like, I don't know, 10 bucks or whatever the ridiculously cheap price is, and dig a hole in your yard and pan your soil. If you don't know how to pan, I recommend checking out the YouTube channel Aussie Bloke Prospector. I learned from him and he's an absolute boss and an expert at what he does. I'd recommend viewing how he pans hard rock gold so that you can learn the very slow and careful approach. Don't rush or be too vigorous. You want a very good idea of what is in your soil and that requires a slow approach, or else you risk washing anything valuable out before you can even deduce if it's present. Just remember, if this gold has been freshly shed from the reef, that means it's still somewhat hydrophobic. Now, I spent the entire day gathering lots of footage, and I found the remains of a mine conglomerate that was outcropping on the top of a hill. It's from an ancient river that was present in Warrandyte during the Jurassic period, 199 to 145 million years ago. And I intend on crushing this and sampling it to see if anything valuable is present. So, until then, thanks for watching.